outside in the sunshine. I really, really, really appreciate that. Thank you. So, I think everybody here's been here before, so we know where the toilets and everything, that sort of thing, don't we? And they know all the sort of general housekeeping stuff. And I think I've got most of your contact details. So this is my lovely, lovely friend, Jill, who has come all the way from America just to be here tonight.
Better be worth it.
Yes. Better be good. And me and Jill have been talking for a while online, haven't we? So this is the first time we've actually seen each other in person, which was quite interesting. But
yeah, that's true. It didn't seem like it was the first time since we've been talking so long and with video chats.
Yeah, it did feel, like I knew. So, and we met on one of the three principles sites online, and we've had some very interesting chats about.
Hello!
Sorry, that's all right, no worries. How are you?
Hello, thank you.
Bye.
You all right?
Yes, thank you. Sorry, a bit
late. No, that's perfect. So, yeah, it's nice to have the aircon as well. So, has anybody tonight to begin? Has anybody come along with anything? Any questions? Anything, you know, that's been on your mind or not on your mind or anything? Because I think everybody here has been to one of these talks before, haven't they? So we haven't got anybody completely sort of new here, anyone who hasn't ever been before. So I think we kind of know what. Basically what the subject matter is, what we're doing here. So has anybody got any sort of questions or anything like that that they would like to open tonight with, or?
I did not come along, I thought of something, I forgot what it was.
It was that important,
it was just a thought.
It was bothering you that much.
It's all about sustaining it. I find myself thinking, that was just a thought. Oh, it's just a thought. But then I sort of forget about it and I carry on letting that thought invade what I'm doing. And even though I'm saying things, I'm thinking I shouldn't be doing this. But I'm still doing it. And I'm like, well, have I got to be constantly going to meetings?
Yeah, forever. That's how I got this. This is all just lies. And that's how I got you to be, keep coming here every single, I'll start doing it, every week soon.
But I can't remember what it was.
But what you just said is actually that's what we do, putting thought on top of that, and that's because you're busy saying I shouldn't be thinking this or I can't get rid of this thought, and so then it becomes another thought. Kathy Casey, somebody I was just at the Three Principles conference, and they were talking about all this stuff. And she had a nice picture where she said, so here's a stick person, and then here's their thought, some squiggles on top of their head, and then all of a sudden they think, just like what you just said, I'm thinking, I shouldn't be doing this, and then that's this bigger thing.
Even bigger
thought,
yes.
It becomes even bigger.
That's right.
But it's all just, it's still
it's
all just
thought. Yeah, I know.
It suddenly sort of occurs to you not to do it as you sort of, that seems to be what happens, doesn't it? Apart from when it doesn't.
That's it, I think. Sometimes. Sometimes I think, well, John, I can't articulate it. It's so weird. I'm saying something. If I hadn't have thought that thought, I wouldn't be saying what I'm saying, but it still seemed important for me to say it. But was it that thought, or was it because I needed to say it? Am I just complicated? I think I've been over intellectualising things for years. I've just got into a habit of doing it.
I think that is a very common thing that we do as well, isn't it? Kind of get into a place
just,
and then...
You've got to know.
It's really helpful to know that is what everyone does too, because so often we think we're the only ones who put thought on top of thought or complicate things, or like everyone I talk to, it's always the same thing. Like, they say just what you said. I mean, it could be anyone in this room. They're probably not going to yet, but I do that. Somehow, it's just normal. Like, that's just the way we function.
Yeah, yeah.
And it is what it is. But also, you don't have to, like, you can know it's just thought and try and think, oh, I don't want to be thinking this, or get away from it. But when you start to realize it's not you, it's not who you are, that all that thinking, like, it's just this voice in your head. It's almost like you could be like, all right, I hear you, you go play with your toys, because it's just like a little kid inside there. I'm just going to get on with my business, and sometimes something like that. And I mean, that's not a prescription, but that just knowing that, like, it's not me, I don't have to listen to you, you're just some crazy person that lives in my head. that's what I am.
And it is like kind of the less notice that you take, because I think before you have any inclination at all, it feels as if a thought is in your mind for a reason and because it's really important. And I think the more you sort of start to look in this direction, start to see, you kind of think, well, I can have any kind of thinking in my head and none of it is important necessarily. Mm. You know, it's kind of like it's just there and it's just doing its thing. And it's sort of almost, it does, somehow or other, you do then feel as if you do, we were talking about this last time, weren't we, this moment that it almost, even if it's only lengthened by the minusculest amount of time, it does feel as if there is a little bit more kind of space in there somehow, and time to kind of, like you said, when you're saying something, you're thinking something, and something's coming out of your mouth and this, and it's like, oh, this is all connected. But even the fact that you're seeing that is something that even feels like a tiny step back from before. That was just happening and you had no concept.
It was just a reaction, yes.
And now you're kind of aware, oh, look, this is happening. I do this and I'm doing this kind of thing.
But I'm still doing it, even though I'm thinking I shouldn't be doing it.
But there is still a moment there, isn't there? Even if it is just the smallest moment, there still is that kind of tiny gap that's happened there.
Right.
That you've come back. That tiny
awareness.
It is. You're awareness of it.
Yeah.
But is the more you kind of start to see the system and see, and like Jill said, be aware that, because we all think it is this, the whole separation thing that gets us into trouble.
Yeah.
And it is very much, we do tend to think we are the only one. You know, whatever is happening to us, we're kind of there. We're individualising ourselves, we're separating ourselves because we're kind of looking at everyone else and saying, well, everyone else has got this cyst. Everyone else's life's perfect.
Yeah, yeah.
And, you know, this, you know, nobody else gets anxious in this kind of thing. You know, you're feeling anxious about something, you're thinking, well, oh gosh, you know, why am I the one that gets anxious? Why am I the one that's, and we sort of separate ourselves out and we don't see that everybody else, even if it might be, kind of have slightly different ingredients in there, everybody is doing that.
Yeah.
Everybody is getting, and sometimes we talk to somebody and say, I was really anxious about this, and they say, oh, that never bothers me. So that kind of even makes you more think, oh, I'm the only one that's like this. But then if you were to go a little bit deeper and to kind of see, because we were talking, oh, hello, hello,
hello,
lovely.
How are you?
I'm good, thanks. And you?
Thanks,
sorry. Emma always makes an entrance, don't you, Emma?
I will do my best.
So, how are you?
Super. Thank you.
We were talking on the way here, weren't we, about Jill has just finished writing a book about, well, she was just trying to decide on the title today, weren't you? But you've written a book about anxiety, haven't you?
Yes.
And we were talking about the sort of loop that we tend to get ourselves into that is the same, it's the same loop that sort of happens. It might play out differently for different, you know, it might be about your relationship, or it might be about your job, or it might be, you know, might have different sort of content in it, but it's this kind of loop that we get in, and you can trace that everybody is doing this same thing, can't you? It's kind of, we kind of trace it back really to insecurity, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
We were sort of talking about, as soon as we have an insecure thought, And I think most of us as human beings, we don't have to have been on this planet very long before we've had our first insecure thought. And once we've kind of had that insecure thought, whatever it happens to be, and sort of believed it and gone down that path and sort of bought into that insecure thought, it seems that then we start. Can you remember the what it was we were saying?
Well, I don't remember exactly what we were saying, but I know I've thought of this myself before, so it's similar, I think, where that, yeah, you like you don't even realize that you're insecure a lot of times. Some people say they're insecure, but like I didn't know I was insecure my whole life. It's just like this, everyone's just looking for love, but because everything else stems from this insecurity, it makes me have this anxiety, like everyone has anxiety, even people who don't. I didn't know I had anxiety. I lived my whole life with this low level of anxiety, so everything I saw or did either scared me in some way, and it stopped me from, you know, it didn't stop me from doing everything. I did lots of stuff, and I had a happy life and things like that, but it you get dragged along by this insecurity and anxiety, because you're just letting it like drag you around, because you're not aware. Like you were just saying, the awareness. Mm-hmm. When you start to see it, when you start to see all the crazy stuff that goes on in your head, like it doesn't have the same effect. You're not dragged around by it as much. So just being aware that you're doing this stuff, like just if you've been to this thing even just once or twice, you've already like so far ahead of the average person who's just being dragged along by their crazy thoughts. But I don't know if there was more to what you were going to say.
I don't know, I just know in the car we were kind of talking about this, the way that we sort of all have, and it plays out in different ways, because I suppose I saw it very clearly because I have done quite a bit of work, it just happened to be what happened, but I've worked quite a lot with people who have been, had addictions, like alcohol addictions, and I have, as it happens, for no particular reason, I don't drink, and it's not, there's no reason, I'd never liked the taste of alcohol when I was little, when I was a kid, when it kind of got to that age, when all my friends were drinking, I just didn't like the taste of alcohol, and I was so fussy, I'd never drank it, and so, that is it, that is the only reason that I don't drink alcohol, so I just don't, and I, for whatever reason, I've never kind of come across a pain, I've never even had a joint or anything, I just haven't done drugs or alcohol, but it's not for any other reason than it just hasn't happened. So it was really weird that I kind of ended up with a lot of people who were kind of like addicts, and I was like, yeah. And then when they started talking to me, I mean, my personal experience has all been, you know, where I got into great difficulties in my life was around relationships. I did really, really terribly in relationships. I was so insecure. And yet when these people started talking to me about their addictions and about what had gone on with their alcohol and, you know, all this kind of thing, I was like, they're just not doing anything different. I could easily talk to them about it, because this loop that we were in, it just so happened that their loop was drugs and alcohol and my loop was relationships. But the loop that I had kind of got myself in was the identical kind of thing. It was like the first thought is something along the lines of, you know, I had this a little bit, the same probably, I just had this kind of low level, I'm not good enough, I'm not, you know, I'm not pretty enough, I'm not, whatever it is, we're just not kind of thing. And then this man comes into my life, you know, and I kind of, he's a good looking man and everything, and he talks to me, and then I'm like, oh, that's amazing, you know, and so I'm like, I can't lose him, I can't lose this man. So then you start to do things, you start to act, instead of acting from a clear mind, and instead of just being who you are, instead of just trusting yourself and being, you believe that the nice feeling that I had when I was with him was something to do with him. It looks like, you know, my good feeling, my okayness, my alrightness came from him. So him leaving was going to be a disaster. So then I'm starting to do stuff to make sure he doesn't leave. And he is equally insecure, so he is doing stuff to make sure I don't leave. And we were talking today, weren't we? This was just so hilarious, because I would spend my days trying to kind of work out how to keep all these balls in the air, if you want, the actual story, this was actually what was happening. My ex-husband actually worked for a company that wore t-shirts with embroidery on them. Now, I happened to be a seamstress and I would embroider these t-shirts. And every now and again, his boss would come to my house to bring a t-shirt. And as soon as this would happen, he would get all insecure that another man had been to the house. And I would know he was going to be like that. So even before he ever came home, I was, oh, what do I do? How do I tell him? What do I do? And then, so the both of us were just playing into this. I was not being myself because I was so insecure about this situation. So then he would come home and go, there's something wrong with you. Why are you acting all weird? You've obviously done something. And this whole circle that we got ourselves into. And to me, you know, when I'm talking to these alcoholics and they're, you know, when I'm talking, it's, they, you know, they would have felt insecure. They would have felt like the world isn't right. They would have had these feelings. Then they would have had a drink and it would have been like, oh, I'm okay. All of that would have gone away for a bit. All this anxiety would have dropped for a minute. Then they attribute this feeling to the alcohol or to the drug or to something. So then we believe that if we don't have this drug or we don't have this alcohol, we are not going to be okay. In exactly the same way as I thought, if this person leaves, I'm not going to be okay. In the same way, all of our life is some kind of, what was it you said, it, life is...
life's one big addiction.
Yeah. And it is kind of whatever it is we have become, whatever it is we have innocently and accidentally attributed our feeling okay to, we are then in deep anxiety that what if we lose that? What if that? What if we lose that? So then we're not kind of living from a clear mind. We're not in a great place. And in exactly the same way, it wasn't actually until we had that conversation about that particular thing that actually happened to me a lot that I actually saw. It was no surprise that he thought I'd been up to something. Because he would come home, and by the time he came home from work, I was, he can't find out about this person that you did my health. Although I hadn't done what he was going to, what he thought was happening, that wasn't what was happening. But actually, I was acting very suspiciously because I wasn't being just myself. I wasn't showing up just as a calm, ordinary, normal human being. I'm in a lot of thinking, I'm in this sort of place. So it's no surprise that his insecurity kicked in and then he does that. And then we're kind of like spiraling. And whether it's another person, whether it's drugs, whether it's alcohol, whether it's, and it can, like you say, very often, it's just stupid, low-level stuff that we kind of tell ourselves. Again, you know, like these, we have boxes or barriers or, you know, I can't, these things, and none of them look to me like they're any different. It's all just this game. And whether it's as ridiculous as that and as obvious as that, or whether it's just these tiny little things that we do, we kind of just keep going round in this ridiculous circle. And
same story, different cover.
Yeah.
I see it as we're always, we're trying to feel better, so we're always seeking happiness outside of ourselves. And that's what I saw for myself. I would make one best friend, because I was very shy and introverted, so I find one best friend and that did just throughout my whole life, even into adulthood, and then I would, you know, cling to that person till they couldn't stand me anymore and pass me aside, you know, after a certain amount of time, and then I'd be like, I'm never gonna have a friend again, because all they do is leave you and blah blah blah. But that was, they made it, I felt so good when I'd have that friend, you know, I'd get their email or they'd call and it was so great. But that was, I thought I needed these friends to make me feel good, or my kids or my husband or whatever. And or some people, it's shopping or it's watching TV or the internet. I'm still addicted to that one. but it's,
yeah, that's like when we
and alcohol for me, I used to drink quite a lot. And but when I had a flash one day in the shower, when I was thinking about it, I knew I had been reading and listening to all this stuff that said, we're born happy. And I'm like, yeah, that makes sense. We're born happy. And happy, that means happiness is inside of me. And I knew that my thoughts were what create my feelings. So if I wasn't happy, it was just my thinking. And the happiness is inside of me. And then just, I had a flash in the shower. I saw all these addictive patterns of my whole life. I just started in a flash. My whole life flashed before my eyes, which I thought was cool that you don't have to die for that to happen. It flashed before my eyes, and then was like, oh, wow, cool. I was seeking happiness outside of me, and it's inside of me the whole time. It's here with me always. I don't need to find other things to make me happy. And after that, like, I just thought that was cool, but, like, I just stopped drinking naturally. I'd still drink. I still drink a glass of wine almost every night, but, like, if I have too many or too fast, like, I don't like that feeling anymore that I was seeking before. But I wasn't even my flash wasn't really about alcohol. It was just about my friendships and things. But it's just to know that happiness is there with you. Always, even when everything's going crazy around you, yeah, you're not always accessing it, but it is there. And so under even the most worst of circumstances, like if you read like Viktor Frankl in the concentration camps, I mean, he managed to somehow remain calm in the face of crazy going on around him. Mm-hmm. But it's really there for everybody. It's accessible. So. For me, it's like I just pay attention a little bit to how I'm feeling, and if I'm not feeling, you know, at least okay, then it just kind of, I don't do anything, but somehow it's like this, like normal or default is like in the middle, you know, this okayness, this goodness, happiness, and then if you start to veer off, you know, stuff's happening around you and you're starting to veer off, it's like you just get back on track a little bit and, feel better without doing anything.
It is just as you start to understand, it starts to make more sense. You start to see that your okayness, and even like if we go back to you kind of saying with all this thinking going on in your mind and everything, I think it is just knowing that it doesn't matter what's going on, because who you truly are underneath, you know, it's like all that stuff that's going on there is just your mind doing these things, your mind doing whatever it is your mind does. And then it's like the foundation, who you really are underneath that. Because all that is just made up in thinking, isn't it? It's just stuff that's going on.
Yeah.
And underneath that, like your foundation, who you truly are more deeply, underneath that, is this love or happiness or, you know, That is what you are. That is the truth of what you are. And then all this thinking kind of comes in, and it almost feels, it's not really a doing, but what it kind of looks like to me is what happens now in that split second that I get, just because I've got somehow understanding this has given me just that little moment somehow. And it feels like I ask myself the question, am I okay even here? But it's not a doing, and I'm not saying, right, so go off now and ask yourself what, but it's almost like that space has kind of given me the space to do that. And it's not, you know, I've told you before, you know, things happen in my life, you know, people get ill, you know, people I know die, stuff like that. It's not like stuff doesn't happen. It's not like life just plays out necessarily any different. It's not like, you know, my children go out and do something, and it's not like nothing happens, but it's like I can have that moment, I can stop and I can find that place, I can find that foundation underneath everything that's going on, I can find that place. And it's not always, you know, some of the things that happened, I definitely don't feel okay for a bit, I definitely don't like it, it absolutely isn't what I want to be going on, but I can still see that in spite, you know, that's what I've made up in thought. That's thought that's kind of saying, this isn't what we want. You know, we don't like this.
That's
we don't want the world to be
it?
This way. We don't want that person to be ill. We don't want that person to die. We don't want that to have happened. That's totally unacceptable. And that's kind of what thought is doing. And then underneath, we can kind of find this place within ourselves. And then in my experience, what tends to happen is we get the best results that we could have possibly have got. You know, even if the things that happened are not the things we would have chosen and not the things we would have wanted. You know, I've worked with people I worked with a lady not too long ago and her baby had died, but she's beginning to come to a place where she can see that that is okay. It's not what she wants, it's not, but there is no going back from that, there is no changing that, and she is beginning to kind of rebuild her life and go on, because we have this amazing resilience to do these things. We are extremely, extremely resilient, and we can go and we can, you know, she's talked to some parents now who've unfortunately experienced the same thing. She's managed to kind of, you know, talk to them. So we do find our way, we do find our place, even when things happen that we don't, it's not that life suddenly starts to be that life doesn't happen and, you know, our kids don't fall over and graze their knees or anything. It's not that that tends to happen. And I don't know, and I'm not sure if there's anyone, I know Iona will, but there was one of the stories that I used to tell an awful lot was about the fact that the relationship that I'm in now is it's a beautiful relationship. I've got a wonderful partner. He's a lovely, lovely man. Early on in our relationship, I loved to dance. And I kind of was in very, very, very much in my story of this man should dance with me. And one of my first massive insights was when I realized